Hi, welcome back. Glad you could join us today. Today I have one of my little friends here. You know, I've got several letters since I've shown these in the previous shows asking how in the world you go about feeding a little squirrel. Well, it's a very delicate operation. Diana has worked with me for a long time. Diana is the bird lady here in Muncie who loaned me this little rascal. And this is how hard it is to get a little squirrel to eat. That's all there is to it. Aren't they the most precious little characters you've ever seen? Yeah, poor guy. He hadn't had nothing to eat for years. You could feed them 10 times a day, and they'll always be just about this hungry. Hey, you know, I have to go to work. Yeah, I have to go to work. Okay? All right. I'm going to set him right over here and let him finish lunch. And while he's doing that, we'll just get started.
There was once a country ruled by a powerful family. The head of this family was a woman known as the Queen, and the Queen had a son known as the Prince, and the family called themselves the Firm. The Firm displayed their prince as a dashing heir to the throne, a Prince Charming, but he was a gentle, retiring man who talked to his plants. And one day he fell in love. She was a young noblewoman after his own heart, with virtues that might have made her a competent queen. Quiet, loyal, fond of horses. And she returned the prince's love. But it was rumored that she was not quite innocent, and the firm worried lest a former lover should sell secrets to the pamphleteers and bring shame on their house. So the prince was ordered to one of the firm's most distant dominions. He had neither the conditioning nor the character to resist, and broken-hearted he went. The noblewoman married another and disappeared from view. With the prince abroad, the firm began the search for a suitable mate for him, a virgin from the nobility, a beauty, a broodmare to ensure the future of the house. And they found her. She was 19, a blank sheet on which they could write, and tall, which pleased the firm, for they were short. She was fair and charmingly shy. She loved children and seemed as pliable as the prince, a flawless rose that had even failed all her O-levels. The wedding, a majestic international celebration, made the story of Cinderella look like social realism. The princess was radiant, and the prince wore a sailor's uniform. A billion people worldwide, more than ever before, watched it on their sedation screens. The new princess took her duties seriously. She gave the firm an heir, then a spare, both sound of wind and limb, and the world applauded. But oh, how the prince longed for his former love, so he went to her from time to time. And oh, how his lack of love for the princess hurt her. For she was a vulnerable girl with a well of affection to give, but nobody except her children to give it to. Miserable, the princess set about doing what she did best. She lent herself to those who were as helpless as she, and the people were glad to have some small part of her because she was a star. She was shot at from the left, who called her Wooden Top, and from the right, who called her Interfering. But she ignored them and became the tactile princess. She shook hands with an untouchable and changed the world for that unfortunate cast. And the friends of Dorothy loved her. She cuddled the damaged children. She hugged the old and the ill and the unwanted. She comforted the victims of war and held the stumps of the amputees. She proclaimed her own disorders, and the people felt she was one of them. And she grew strong. Meanwhile, the people saw that the prince and the princess did not love each other. Gossips tattled, presses rolled, airwaves crackled, and the world gobbled it all. both the prince and the princess hired busybodies to fight their corners. The prince's affair became public. The princess had liaisons with unsuitable partners. It was even rumored that one of them had fathered her younger son. The snoops and the pamphleteers hounded her everywhere. The prince spoke of his love for another, but the world looked at the princess's dress. He was vanquished in the public brawl. A star will always outshine its satellite. The firm could keep the prince and princess together no longer, and they divorced. Relieved, the prince rushed back to the arms of his true love, the noblewoman, who divorced her husband. The firm offered private terms to the princess, which she publicized, for she was no longer pliable. And she was eventually pleased to accept a very different sum. With her newfound single status, she plunged with even more enthusiasm into her good works, earning enormous praise, but fulsome derision too. No matter. Charities fought for the dazzling, still shy smile that opened hearts and coffers. But the snoops harassed her with renewed vigor, for the people were greedy for her every breath. Yet there were some who wished that the prince and his true love, the princess and her lovers, indeed the whole firm and their lickspittles, would all just go away and leave the money in the till. Then fate put in its bloody oar. One night, the princess was killed, suddenly, in a shocking and unnecessary accident, as she and one of her lovers were fleeing from the snoops. Many said that these tattlehounds had killed her. Some said it was the firm. But surely, it was the insatiable hunger of the multitudes, and her hunger for love. The world stopped for a moment in numbed horror. Then, as the full meaning sank in, the grieving started on a scale no soothsayer foresaw. The firm observed the formalities according to their traditions. They went to ground, showed no emotion, and waited for the sorrow of the people to pass. All would be all right now that that turbulent woman was gone. But it wasn't. The people had let out a sigh of anguish that was echoing round the world. Even the indifferent and the cynical looked into themselves and were surprised to find a sense of loss. The absence of any cries of pain from the firm was bitterly noted. The firm at last joined in the chorus, but it was too late. Once again, there was a battle for the people's favor, only now there was no princess to fight her corner, so the people fought it for her. The English rose had become England's rose. The people came in their multitudes to say goodbye to their princess. 2 billion people, more than ever before, watched their sedation screens and wept as she was carried through the streets. The princess's brother, a nobleman of temporarily inflated consequence, stood in the pulpit of the great temple and poured scorn on the firm in revenge for his wronged sister. Then, from outside the temple, came a noise like the patter of many running feet. It swept across the parks, down the avenues, round the square outside, and was irresistible. It was the sound of growing applause. It surged through the open doors of the great temple, was taken up by the congregation, and engulfed the nave. And the great and the good joined in. The people were speaking. The country held its breath, as the firm sat still and stony-faced. It seemed like one of those moments depicted by the great playwright when one mighty family challenges the rule of another. The applause turned into a cheer, which became a roar, which reverberated across the land, an earthquake of emotion that was meant to swallow up the firm and all its works, leaving only justice and love. But it soon passed, a noise that was soon forgotten. The people had spoken, but they had not acted. And so it came to pass that 14 years later, there was another majestic wedding. The elder of the two young princes had come of age. The bride was the young prince's teenage sweetheart, not of the nobility, but an urchin neither, known to the firm as the commoner, the first to be accepted by them for many generations. Her patience had earned her her place, and this time the firm had not stood in the way of their prince's heart. They even let her family stand near them in the great palace. The people rejoiced because she was one of them, and thus they felt part of the firm, and the firm part of them, which it wasn't. It was another international celebration, watched by billions on their sedation screens. This time, the young prince wore a pilot's uniform, but once again, the world looked at the bride's dress, a dress thought to be even more beautiful than the now forgotten dead princess's. The bridesmaids were led by the commoner's sister, equally lovely in pure white, and the world admired her rear. The firm was outshone once again. Their own young women were even called the Ugly Sisters. Some suggested history was repeating, but it was just the wheel of life turning once more. And even the most hardened cynics were mollified by the splendor. And the young prince's father, the former Prince Charming, who had with great discretion at last married his true love, did smile. For this time, it seemed the couple had married for love, or something like that anyway.
Hey everyone, I just want to tell you that, you know all that embarrassing stuff that you always think about and go, oh, I can't believe I did that? Well, hardly anyone even remembers that. And the few people that do remember it, they don't give a shit anymore. And to be honest, they didn't even give that much of a shit at the time it happened. So, don't worry. Okay? Peace.
Capitalism isn't working. So a couple of years ago, I made a video called... I actually don't remember what it was called. It was about capitalism and how I found the idea of smashing capitalism to be infantile. One argument that I made was, well, how are you going to get your avocados for your vegan burrito? What incentive are people going to have to move those sorts of foods over long distances? However, I'd made a terrible mistake. It's the same mistake that many people who think that they're libertarians end up making. Since the word capitalism is so propagandized, a lot of people conflate it with a lot of terms that are not related to it at all. In the video that I'm mentioning, I had conflated the terms capitalism with markets, which are two totally different things. Capitalism has very little to do with markets. Capitalism simply means that we as a society think that it's okay that a group of rich people should be able to buy everything and then become even richer by the fact that they own everything. Capitalism necessitates the abuse of labor. It is in the DNA of capitalism that labor must be abused and exploited. It's under capitalism that a worker builds a house and then has to pay the capitalist for the right to live in the house that the worker built. It's under capitalism that a worker makes hundreds of shoes a day, but is paid so little for his labor by the capitalist who owns the factory that he cannot, with a day's wages, buy a single pair of shoes that he has made. It's under capitalism that a worker makes enough clothing to clothe an entire community in a day, but are paid so little that they would have to save for weeks in order to purchase one shirt. It's under capitalism that workers harvest enough food to feed an entire village every day from the fields that the capitalist owns, but have to pay the capitalist a day's wages just to get one meal's worth of food. You don't have to think about this very hard to come to understand why so many of our brothers and sisters are homeless, shoeless, naked, and hungry. The game is rigged that way. These things, the field, the farm, the factory, the financial institution, these are what people refer to when they say the means of production. What is the value that the capitalist provides in these circumstances? The capitalist does no labor. Simply through owning the factory, the field, the financial institution, capitalists are able to create even more wealth for themselves simply by exploiting the labor of their fellow human beings. At what point did we decide that that was a good way to organize our society. Now, it's often said that capitalism is an economic system, but that is a complete misnomer. Systems are self-sustaining closed loops. Capitalism is a straight line. What do I mean by that? Well, have you ever played the game Monopoly? Well, Monopoly and capitalism operate under very similar rules. So long as everybody has fairly equal shares of property and the money keeps moving around the table, the game can go on for quite a long time. But inevitably, somebody gets enough of an upper hand that you can quickly see that this game is rigged and there is a definite ending. At that point, the game is already over. People start losing their homes in order to pay their bills. Sudden expenses come up that you can't budget for. You start losing the things that allow you to participate in the game. Slowly and surely, one person ends up owning everything. And then the balance of power tips forever in their direction. So eventually all the money and all the property ends up in the hands of just one person. And that is how you win Monopoly. And that's also how you win capitalism. And that is where we're at right now. Just on the precipice, just before the super wealthy end up owning everything and every property on the game board and all the money in the bank, until the point where the rest of us are unable to play the game at all. To the 1%, to the Koch brothers, I say congratulations, you win at capitalism. Nobody else has anything, so you win. Now, another word that people use as a stand-in for capitalism is democracy. But democracy and capitalism really could not be any more different from one another. Under capitalism, your workplace is organized in a hierarchical structure, in which one person or a small group of people own everything, make all the decisions, and reap all the profits from the labor of those who work for them. The workers have no input in how their business is run. The workers have no input in how their fellow workers are treated. If your average capitalist workplace was a government, we would call it fascist. So let's call it what it is. Fascism. Worker-owned autonomous workplaces, however, are different. They look very different from capitalism. Under worker-owned and operated cooperatives, the workers share ownership of the means of production. Everybody is in charge. They're all paid equally for their labor. They all share equally in the profits and equally in the losses. Workers come to consensus on how to run their business, on how to treat their fellow employees. If this workplace were a government, we would call it a democracy. Another word for democracy in the workplace is socialism. So I also want to get to the point that socialism and markets are not mutually exclusive. In fact, there are many worker-owned cooperatives that exist and are thriving in our current market economy. Cooperatives that you probably already know about but didn't know that they were cooperatives, like Land O'Lakes Butter. Most workplaces are capitalist, which means there is very little to no democracy in our economy, which means that a very few are enriched at the exploitation of the many. And in a society where money is legally equivalent to political speech, and where it is practically equivalent to power, it is quite clear that capitalism creates a ruling class regardless of the form of government. It is quite clear that capitalism is the opposite of democracy. The lack of democracy in the workplace is the root cause of why there is so little democracy in our government. For information on how to reclaim democracy in the workplace, go to usworker.coop. Solidarity.
One tear gas grenade, 1649. 10 zip tie handcuffs, 1395. One box of rubber bullets, $17.99. One pair of black combat boots, $99. The realization that you pay the salary of the thug who's smashing your face into the pavement with that boot while his buddies handcuff your fellow protesters and fire rubber bullets into the crowd? Priceless. There's some things that banker-controlled, debt-based money and forced taxation can't buy. For everything else, well, you fill in the blanks.
Welcome back to the Kaiser Report. I'm Max Kaiser. Time now to go to Spain to talk with Paul Moore. He's the former head of regulatory risk at Halifax Bank of Scotland, otherwise known as HBOS, before he became a whistleblower. Paul has put himself forward to serve as interim chairman of Barclays Bank. while they go through the period of roughness there. Paul, welcome to the Kaiser Report.
Thanks. It's difficult to think about banking when you're on a sunny beach in Spain.
Well, let's get into it. We'll try to get pry some interesting information from you. So first, tell us about your role as a whistleblower at HBOS. What did the bank and what did regulators do upon receiving your information?
Well, it's a very simple story. I told the board that they should reconsider their strategy for sales growth if they wish to avoid risks to customers and colleagues. And the chief executive fired me. I asked for protection from the non-executives and the regulator, and I demanded an independent investigation. Well, nobody protected me. Nobody listened.
Okay, so your former job was group regulatory risk. Does that basically mean your job was to make sure that the bank was not exposed to any regulatory oversight?
Absolutely not. I mean, I think that's part of the problem. The idea that people who lead internal control functions should seek to arbitrage all the regulatory requirements drives a coach and horses through the whole idea. In the UK, we have what's called an approved persons regime, which meant that I had a direct contract between myself and the regulators. It's not my job to do that. My job is to make sure that the bank is following the requirements within a reasonable margin. And it's a bit like a telemetrist or an engineer in a Formula One team. It's my job to help the car go around the track rapidly, but not so fast that it blows the engine up or crashes into the tire walls.
Right, but your role is that single point of failure between the banks and the regulatory obligations. You're the interface between those two things. You were unhappy with what you were seeing. You became a whistleblower. But essentially, my question is, there is a role at the bank where they have one foot at the bank, one foot really serving the regulatory interests, and this layer is corrupt in a big way, isn't it?
Well, it just doesn't work. Imagine if I'm reporting to the executive and they disagree with me and they have the power over my life or death, it's not going to work. So I've made very simple recommendations, which is control functions, that's risk, compliance, internal audit, should never report to the executive, should always report to the non-executive, and that there should be new policy around whistleblowing for those types of people that means they cannot be fired without a proper meeting of the non-executives and that removal must be approved by the regulator. Otherwise, the system fails, as you said.
All right, now, Paul, what percentage of those working in regulatory oversight and compliance in the industry are clean? That is to say, they're not corrupt. When I was working on Wall Street, for example, at Payne Weber and Oppenheimer and Shearson, Every year, Christmas time, I would bribe our compliance officer, as did every broker at these firms. There was known that the compliance officer was crooked. You gave him a big enough Christmas bonus, and he overlooks margin requirement deficiencies. He overlooks fraud. He overlooks all the tricks of the trade. So what percentage of these guys that you were in that business are clean? They're actually doing the business in a clean way.
There's two points. The first is you have to have no professional qualifications to be a chief risk officer, a chief compliance officer, or a chief internal auditor. And so that's one thing. The second thing is if you report to the executive, well, hang on a second, you stick your head above the parapet and the messenger gets well and truly shot. So I don't know the answer to the question, but I wouldn't be at all surprised if it's quite a lot of people who are going to be prepared to oversee or miss things that they should cover. So the whole system doesn't work.
Yeah, well, I mean, I guess from my experience, I never met in my many years on Wall Street a compliance officer that wasn't dirty. Now, since you blew the whistle, Paul, the entire banking system has gone into meltdown caused by the fraud that you warned about. Of this financial crisis, you said, quote, "The banking crisis isn't just about becoming poorer, it's about killing people. We never held anyone to account. We haven't done the radical reforming job we needed to do." Can you talk a little bit about that, Paul Moore?
Yeah, number one, everybody says and thinks the banking crisis is just about money. Well, money affects people's lives. The United Nations have estimated that the banking crisis drove 100 million people back into poverty around the world. The mortality statistics and morbidity statistic, that means the number of extra people who die and the number of extra people who are ill, rises dramatically when you're in poverty. And so I don't know the exact number, but I would be very surprised if the banking crisis didn't kill more people than any single conflict since the Second World War. So that's the first point. What was the second point you were asking me about?
You were talking about the banking crisis, part and parcel, killing people.
Yeah.
And we never held anyone to account, and we haven't done the radical reforming we need to do.
Well, I think The Inside Job, that fantastic film, demonstrated the point. Who's in charge of the democracies, the big democracies where financial services go on in the world? Well, it's certainly weapons, oil, financial services, pharmaceuticals, etc. It's not a democracy, it's a corporatocracy. So it's an inside job. We've got a situation in which we cannot get to the bottom of things because those with the vested interests in maintaining the status quo and avoiding their own accountability are in charge of everything. They've got the money. They fund the political parties. I know it's written into the US Constitution, private funding of political parties, but frankly, I think it creates a level of corruption that is very serious for the world. It's really just wrong. The vested interest have protected themselves from being held to account. They've protected themselves from a proper, detailed forensic investigation, and they've protected themselves from any proper reform. So it's just wrong.
All right, now you mentioned that this crisis has put 100 million people or more into poverty. Of that group, a certain percentage will die. You make this point very clear. Not since World War II have we had this type of purposeful ushering into poverty by a corpocracy, a kleptocracy, a kakistocracy, if you will. My point has been, and I want your thoughts on it, because a lot of people in the U.S. mainstream media portray this as a victimless crime. I have stated that it is creating millions of victims. And if you use the World War II comparison, Paul Moore, is it wrong to say that this is essentially a financial holocaust?
I think that's, I love the words you use. Yes, that's a brilliant way of putting it, and I subscribe to that view. Just even if you haven't died, even if you haven't become very sick because you've been driven into poverty, your life has been made miserable by the austerity thrown upon you by bailing out the banks and making the rest of us pay for it. You're right, it's a corporatocracy, not a democracy, and we've got to do something about it. We're only going to do something about it if we build a mass movement of people, do some Martin Luther King-like non-violent resistance actions. We're in a right old muddle, that's what we'd say in England.
All right, now, Paul Moore, you say we need radical reform. But it's interesting. If you took away fraud, what would you have left? Wouldn't the UK banking system as we know it disappear? It's like a rusted out car. It has the shape of a car, but it's mostly rust. The UK banking system has the shape of a functioning banking system, but it's mostly fraud. If you took the fraud away, would there be anything left?
Well, there'd be what there should be. Look, it's not just investment banks that have manipulated markets through proprietary trading. It's retail banks that have time after time after time missold systemically to ordinary people things that they don't want, don't understand, and don't need. You can count dozens of times that they've done this. So what is a bank? Well, it's supposed to be boring, isn't it? It's not supposed to be kind of highly complicated. By the way, proprietary trading is tantamount to the manipulation of markets through a dominant position in information, generally derived from conflicts of interest, a dominant position in mathematical science, and a dominant position in computer science. And look, just last week we saw that company whose mathematics and computer science went wrong. It cost them a fortune. I can't remember their name now.
Knight Capital.
Yeah.
Well, when you talk about proprietary trading as having dominant position, isn't that the same as saying that they have inside information?
Yes, it is. And you can liken this proprietary trading, which, by the way, isn't banking business. Think about it for a minute. What's it got to do with banking? I don't mind somebody investing in a hedge fund and taking risk with their own capital, so long as that hedge fund follows the rules. But what is proprietary trading got to do with banking? It's not got anything to do with banking. It's gambling. It's taking positions. Now, why can they make so much money out of it? Because they've got more information than anybody else. Where do they get it from? Generally from the inside in one way or the other. But they also use highly sophisticated mathematical models and highly sophisticated computer systems to do things, which means the rest of us cannot invest in the market properly. Now, they say, oh, well, hang on a second. It gives us liquidity. Well, hang on a second. We've got too much liquidity. And if you just think of shares and other financial instruments as, I don't know, chips in a casino, well, frankly, it doesn't do any good for anybody. So it's essentially gambling in a rigged market, which they rig. Go and ask any day trader, read the Big Short. It explains exactly what happens. It's wrong.
Paul Moore, the bulk of the global financial scandal, whether it's AIG, MF Global, Lehman Brothers, the whale trade from JP Morgan, the list goes on, all goes through London. London apparently has the worst regulatory environment in the world. And of course, Blythe Masters of JP Morgan, the wicked witch of derivatives, also is based in London. London itself, and also we learned from MF Global that unlike the United States, instead of being able to hypothecate or rehypothecate 140% of a security and for a lending requirement, you can rehypothecate to infinity in London. You can resell the same thing over and over and over again. What about this regulatory environment in London? When is the cesspool in London going to shut down?
Actually, if you look at the regulatory rules and the system, it's not bad at all. It's not that they didn't have the power. It's that they didn't enforce the rules. And we haven't invested in white-collar crime properly. You can steal a water bottle in a riot and get put in prison for 30 days, and David Cameron can, rant on about how bad they were, and yet you can missell anything from a bank and monetize your illegality and morality. We don't do enforcement properly. That's the problem. We don't enforce people. I've made this abundantly clear. We need to separate out the policy and rule setting and day-to-day supervision from investigation and enforcement. And we need to have a completely open and transparent tribunal. So these things, these wrongdoings, although they're called regulatory, are tantamount to criminal offences, and they should be held in public so that people like you can watch what they're doing and make sure that people are held to account. And that doesn't happen.
All right, Paul Moore, I'd love to continue, but we're out of time. I have to say goodbye. Thanks so much for being on the Kaiser Report.
I've enjoyed it. Let's do it again.
Excellent. All right, and that's going to do it for this edition of the Kaiser Report with me, Max Kaiser, and Stacey Herbert. I want to thank my guest, Paul Moore. If you want to send me an email, please do so at kaiserreport@rttv.ru. Until next time, Max Kaiser saying bye, y'all.
There's good reason for my glistening skin and how I shine and how my pores are so clean and clear. I eat little baby's ice cream. It keeps me young. It keeps me light on my feet. I spring from activity to activity. I love my job. I love my life. When you eat little baby's ice cream, you'll wink and nod and hug and high-five each other with great enthusiasm. This is a special time. Little baby's ice cream. Ice cream is a feeling. Thank you.
That's all.